Hello, welcome everybody. My name is Joe Barton. I'm one of the trustees at the Moya Library Ross Historical Society. Thank you for joining us today. We're very pleased that we've had nearly 100 register for this event. So welcome to each and every one of you. Now, before launching into our program and turning it over to Richard and our guest speaker today for this presentation of the Branson School Centennial, just a few reminders. This is a Zoom webinar, which means that you, the guests, can see us and hear us, but we cannot see you and we cannot hear you. Therefore, the best way to, if you have a question, use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. During the presentation, you can type in a question and our guest speaker, Laurie, can address those questions following her presentation. So now, now I'd like to invite Richard to unmute himself and introduce today's program.
All right, thank you, Joe, and thank all of you signed in. We appreciate your interest. The Jose Moya Del Pino Library and Ross Historical Society are celebrating our 50th year of these first Friday forenoon presentations. We were able to have our March program before the COVID sheltering. However, we did have to cancel our April, May, and June. But here it is September, and we're 50 years of doing it, and it's the first time it's ever been a Zoom webinar. We will be going ahead with our October 2nd and November 6th program. October 2nd will feature historian and scholar John Freeman, who is sharing his research about the centennial of Prohibition and the Volstead Act. A lot of interesting things were going on in Marin County, and that's what his show will be about. Then on November 6th, Dr. Gray Brecken will present his findings about how Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal, which was designed to bring this country out of the Depression, how projects all around the country and around the Bay Area changed the way people lived, and many of those projects are still right here under our noses. So they both should be interesting shows, and I encourage you to sign up. The posters are on our website, and the link to sign up is there, so hope to see you at those next meetings. Today, I'm very pleased to introduce our guest speaker, Laurie Deibel, who will present her in-depth research and many selections from the Branson School Archives as the school commemorates its 100th year. If you have questions, use the Q&A format, as Joe mentioned, and Laurie will answer the questions at the end of the program. Now, Laurie and her husband, Chris, are lifelong residents of Marin County, and in fact, her parents met at the College of Marin in 1950. She has been at Branson since 2002, after a career in law and business librarian in San Francisco and Marin. She feels doubly blessed to be part of the Branson community as her daughter graduated in 2017 and is now pursuing her master's degree in natural resources at Oregon State University. When she's not at Branson, Laurie enjoys following her father's passion for genealogy, finishing all of the Sunday paper crosswords in 1 week, and chipping away at the mountain of books at her bedside. So please welcome Laurie Deibel.
Thank you, Richard. And I want to see if I can share my screen. Joe, if you could make me the host. I'm hoping he hears me, Joe. There we go. Thank you.
You should have it now. Yeah.
I got it. There we are. Thank you. And hello, everybody, and welcome to a quick journey through the Branson School's first 100 years. Back in 2006, I was asked to pull together the school's memorabilia, publications, photographs, and documents that were scattered all over campus, in closets, offices, and often in basements where they had sat forgotten for years. Since then, I have digitized thousands of artifacts, cataloged them, and made them available to our community on a searchable website. In the years leading up to our centennial, this database has been a useful resource for answering questions from alums, staff, and even outside parties. In addition, our history department uses the collection for instruction, and every year I conduct a lesson for the freshmen about discovering the history of their school based on the newspapers, photographs, documents, and publications that I present to them as primary source evidence. Even after all these years, I'm still finding amazing treasures in our archives. Just this week, I sent two reels of film from 1930 to Kodak for digitization, and there are many more waiting to be processed. I would like to acknowledge that while building this narrative, I have borrowed from the work of Dr. Dennis Shannon, a former Branson history teacher and the contributor to an upcoming book celebrating our centennial. Because of time constraints, I will concentrate on our first 50 years. So let's begin. In the 1910s, the growing population of San Rafael put some pressure on already overcrowded schools. The San Francisco Examiner published an article in August of 1917 on San Rafael public schools, condemning their poor quality and overcrowding, and concluded by noting that many good teachers were leaving teaching. There were very few alternatives available for the families that had begun to take up residence in the growing town. In addition, the private schools at that time were male only. The time was ripe for establishing a college preparatory school for girls in San Rafael. Marin County Superior Court Judge Edgar T. Zook and businessmen Eric Ord and George Hind all had young daughters, and they wanted a private school education for their girls. They acquired in early 1917 the site of Miss Stewart's School, which consisted of an old barn with two large rooms and an attic in downtown San Rafael at 5th and D Streets, near what is today San Rafael City Hall. The Little Gray School opened in the fall of 1917, with two teachers and 28 boys and girls in grades 1 through 4. Registration increased during the year, and the demand for higher grades made it necessary to secure another building and an additional teacher. Enrollment demands led the school's founders to add intermediate grades in 1918, and after the trustees leased this former Victorian boarding house on an adjoining property, they renamed the school again as the San Rafael School for Girls. Boys would continue to be counted among its pupils in the primary grades, but a growing emphasis would be placed upon developing an environment and curriculum to attract older girls. Here you see a great picture of the students of the growing school on the steps of the newly acquired Victorian on 5th Street. Here's a view inside the classrooms. And here are students doing exercises behind the Carnegie Library in San Rafael, which should give you a good sense of the school's location. By 1920, they were looking for a headmistress to move the school in a more academically rigorous direction and to prepare the upper school students for college. A founding trustee of the school, Clara Hamilton Martin, contacted the dean of Bryn Mawr, where her eldest daughter attended college, for recommendations for candidates. And this is how they found Catherine Branson. She was a Latin teacher and administrator from private schools in the East Coast, and with her sister Laura, a mathematics teacher, they were approached to become co-headmistresses of the school. In her letters to the Branson sisters, Mrs. Martin spoke of the problems of attendance then plaguing the San Rafael school, owing in large part to illnesses brought on by the 1918 flu epidemic, and talked of the trustees' future plans and means to expand the day school to one that included residents, with primary grades fueling the growth of the upper school. Although the sisters were reluctant at first to move to California, the trustees persuaded them to take the helm as co-headmistresses in the summer of 1920. Knowing that Miss Branson brought strength of character, along with expectations of high academic standards, the trustees renamed the school in her honor. Here you can see students on the steps of the San Rafael campus in 1920 holding a banner for the newly renamed Catherine Branson School. In the spring of 1920, in the May edition of the little school's newspaper, The Star Shell, the editors greeted the news of the impending changes at their school with delight. Quote, "We feel that the future of our school is now assured through the constant efforts of the directors we have been able to get two very fine women, graduates of Bryn Mawr, the Mrs. Branson, to take charge of the school." At a time when most secondary schools for girls prepared them for marriage and motherhood, Catherine and Laura wanted more for the school that they chose to lead. As the school brochure stated in the 1920s, "The purpose of the Catherine Branson School is to give girls a thorough foundation, which will fit them to enter any of the American colleges and universities, and will prepare them to take an active and intelligent part in the activities of any community in which they may live." School officially opened for the first time as the Catherine Branson School on September 6, 1920, with 54 students, three of whom were now in residence. The Branson sisters soon began to establish lasting traditions at the school. That fall witnessed the forming of the first glee club, the performance of the school's first Christmas play, and an excursion at Mount Tamalpais. That winter, too, found the students divided into two teams, the Blue Bonnets and the Tam O'Shanters, which competed against each other in school activities. The teams also represented the sisters' favorite colors, blue and green, which remain our school colors today. Here you see our basketball team winning their first game in 1920 against Miss Randolph's school in Berkeley with a score of 48-23. The Blueprint, a literary magazine featuring articles and stories written by Branson students, was launched that September, and it became a central feature of the school for 40 years. The running feature, School Notes, also gives us a wonderful glimpse of day-to-day life at school, as 3 to 4 times a year it was sent out to families as a record of their girls' lives at KBS. By spring, the Branson sisters had inaugurated the first College Board exams, the school's first community service organization, the first spring play, and because the school had yet to graduate its first pupil, the sisters created Prize Day in June to celebrate the conclusion of the school year. The secluded field on our Ross campus where we hold our graduation ceremonies is still called Prize Day Field. Catherine and Laura Branson also introduced the school's fabled motto, the final couplet of John Keats' Ode on a Grecian Urn, "Beauty is truth, truth beauty." For decades, students would question Miss Branson on her choice of school motto, to which she would reply, "You may have glimpses of it in the midst of the simplest happenings. You may glimpse it in a great experience of happiness or sorrow, and for each of you, its meaning may be different." As the school grew to 64 day and 10 boarding students, the trustees knew they had to find a more suitable location for the school, far from the expanding attractions and equally challenging diversions of downtown San Rafael. In early 1922, they secured the purchase of the secluded estate that locals called the John Martin Place in Ross. Here you see Miss Branson in front on the bridge we still cross every day as she surveys the property. And again, at the top of the hill behind John Martin's residence. The move was noteworthy enough to make it into the Marin Journal, the predecessor of today's IJ. John Martin was born in Indianapolis, raised in Brooklyn, and according to a PG&E biography, was largely on his own from the age of 13. When he came west in 1891, he met Eugene de Sable, and over the next 10 years, they built power plants and consolidated existing gas and electric systems. In 1905, they merged with San Francisco Gas and Electric, forming what we now know as Pacific Gas and Electric. In addition to his directorship of PG&E, Martin was the president of the North Shore Railroad, which became the Northwestern Pacific Railroad, literally laying the tracks for our current smart system. Shortly after the 1906 earthquake, Martin purchased 13 acres from the Albert Dibley estate named Fernhill, which had luxurious gardens and exotic trees first laid out by the avid gardener Dibley in the 19th century. The Dibley family came to Ross in about 1870 after Mr. Dibley had established a successful shipping business in San Francisco. According to an interview with his grandson in 1975, the original property was bordered on the north by Bolinas Avenue and went all the way from Sir Francis Drake Boulevard up to the timberline on Bald Hill, followed that line to the road leading to Phoenix Lake, down Lagunitas to circle back to Sir Francis Drake, 75 acres in total. Today's Fernhill Drive was Mr. Dibley's driveway, and most of the stately elms along that road and Shady Lane were planted by him. I'd like to thank Carol Aquaviva of the Antique Kent California Room for sharing this map of the Dibley Estate from 1896. And here are some perspectives of the newly constructed John Martin Estate. Here's the iconic gate that we actually just replaced about 10 years ago because of earthquake concerns. Here we are coming onto campus or onto the estate. And here is John Martin's residence, which still stands, of course. And I'd like you to notice that the giant blue spruce tree that is there and is a central part of our campus has not yet been planted. Here's another aspect of the residence. And finally, the rear of the residence, looking very much as it does today. This is the view from the residence down the valley into what we now call, of course, the Academic Quad. And the building that you see in the far distance is, or was, his stables. And you'll see that. And by the way, this is the view that I see every day when I exit my office. Here's Mr. Martin himself standing outside on the porch looking out. And this is a great picture. This is the interior, obviously the main living room of his home. And I use this photograph when I'm teaching the freshmen because they are seated in this room in the library when I have this lesson. And they look at this photograph and I ask them to identify it. And they all have that same surprise when they look up and they see the beautiful fireplace that's right before them. Here's the view outside by the porch. And this is a view, of that stable house and the carriage house that is now in our academic quad. The beauty and seclusion of the Ross property was exactly what the school founders were looking for when wishing to permanently establish a girls' resident and day school. Even today, after a century of construction, remodeling, and change, we still enjoy the same pastoral calm and protected solitude that drew them to the campus. This fun photo is of primary school boys on the steps of Residence Hall as part of the Spring Revels in 1922. Catherine and Laura Branson immediately set about designing a curriculum for a college preparatory school and revitalized its academic caliber, based in large part by their own educational experience at Bryn Mawr and schools that they had worked at in the East. School opened on the Ross campus in September of 1922, with 93 students now enrolled, 18 of whom were boys. In addition to a more rigorous academic program, Catherine, the more stern and authoritarian sister, set a high tone for the school. She introduced plaid and gingham uniforms for the girls, which were inspected every morning, and the girls were checked for forbidden makeup or jewelry. Girls would be required to wear the gingham and plaid until the mid-1980s. Every Sunday, the boarding students were escorted to St. John's Church on Shady Lane, where senior vespers were also held every June, well into the 1960s. I thought members of the Ross Historical Society would enjoy these early photos from our collection. The campus in Ross was served by commuter electric rail, with stations at both Bolinas Avenue and at Ross Common for commuter students to catch a train ride to and from school. Some day students commuted by car, and others were transported via a bus that you see here that the trustees had leased to bring the girls and boys to the new campus from downtown San Rafael. Upon arriving in Ross, the school's trustees began a campaign to remodel the Martin Estate buildings and build an expansive boarding program. The most ambitious of these plans was to replace John Martin's pond with a swimming pool and the construction of a gymnasium. Students went door to door in Ross gathering subscriptions. And the pool, completed in 1925, added immeasurably to the school's athletic offerings. The gym and tennis courts, completed in 1928, also expanded recreational activities available to the students. By 1927, the school had grown to nearly 50 full-time residents from all over the Western United States, who would have lived during the school year in one of these dorm rooms scattered in buildings around the upper campus. Here you see Miss Branson on the porch of Residence Hall at the first alumni meeting held in 1926. By that time, we had a total of 9 alums. In 1929, the school expanded by purchasing One Circle Drive, used as the infirmary and later as the home for the head of school, and at least the nearby Fasken home for dormitories. Theatrics was always a part of KBS, and in 1926, the Spring Revels turned into Play Week, when lessons were dropped and every student, faculty member, and even Miss Branson herself pitched in to build sets, sew costumes, print programs, produce, act, or direct a play chosen by the teachers and students. The plays were first held in the front lawn beneath the Blue Spruce. Here you see a production of Robin Hood in 1926. In 1929, the production of The Golden Doom was significant for 2 reasons. It was the first play performed in the academic area we now call the Quad, and it featured the tallest member of the student body that you can see here, central in front of the tree. Julia McWilliams of the class of 1930 later became world famous as the French chef, Julia Child. In the words of one student at the time, the keynote of Play Week is teamwork. Without it, nothing could have been accomplished. Our school's commitment to the arts has never wavered, and that spirit of teamwork can be seen at every performance, every exhibition, every concert, and most especially when our school devotes an entire day to the arts every year at the Festival of Arts at Branson, or FAB. At the dawn of the 1930s, the Great Depression had an almost immediate and significant impact upon the school. Plans to expand upon and improve the existing buildings had to be scrapped in 1930. Tuition and teacher salaries had to be lowered. Many of the service staff was let go. And in the fall of 1932, enrollment was lower than it had ever been at the Ross campus. In 1933, because of dwindling numbers, the school stopped admitting boys and began phasing out the younger grades, so that by 1936, the Katherine Branson School was exclusively a girls' school, grades 5 through 12. The economic devastation of the 1930s touched the students deeply. Several nearby homes in Ross were abandoned, and families were facing financial difficulties unimaginable just a few years before. In 1935, knowing that the Board of Trustees were unable to finance the purchase of the Manning home, which had been originally built by John Martin for his daughter, Charles Carruthers purchased it privately and promised Miss Branson that it would be offered to the school when his youngest graduated from college. This home would eventually be purchased in 1954, and we still call it New House 66 years later. Despite the economic difficulties, the school continued many of the cherished traditions from the previous decade. Christmas carols were sung on the last day of school before break, beginning with a march through the orchard up the road to the lawn where the blue spruce served as the Christmas tree. This tradition continues today. Launches on the Bay, begun in 1924, continued on into the next decade, even though the launch rides around Alcatraz and Angel Island sometimes made the girls shudder, they recalled, as they passed 2 imposing installations, one a working federal prison, and the other a federal quarantine and immigration station. Frequent hikes to Mount Tam and the surrounding hills and lakes were led by the Vagabond Club. Here you see them on Mount Baldy, and again at Phoenix Lake. Athletic competition on campus between the Tam O'Shanters and the Blue Bonnets continued in basketball, archery, and swimming, as well as baseball and track. The girls wore white dresses and carried large bouquets of flowers at graduation, another tradition that lasted well into this century. Newer traditions of the 1930s reflected the varied interests of the students, including the Ponies Club that was created in 1938. During the Depression, Miss Branson continued to stress the importance of honor, morality, and truth. Her own quiet dignity, seriousness of purpose, and her demanding and aloof manner all served to remind the young women that the Katherine Branson School was dedicated to the most rigorous academic and highest personal standards. Honor Council, selected by the votes of students and faculty, enforce the many rules of the residence and general uniform and school rules for all. Honor continues to have an important role in all aspects of our school, and alums and current students are usually unanimous in their belief and pride in the school's honor code. Skirts had to be the proper length, no gum chewing, no smoking, no noise after lights out, no food in the residence, and rooms daily left neat and tidy. Here you can see students lined up for inspections in residence hall in 1932, right outside my current office in the library. Students often found the standards of personal integrity and the exacting academic standards inhibiting and stifling. As one alum recalled, very old-fashioned virtues were stressed at the school at the time. But even with all the rigid rules and the seriousness that marked so many of the day-to-day experiences of the school, alumni recall fondly the idyllic campus and surrounding countryside and dodging the strict rules. One famous story has a student on a cookie run to the kitchen maneuvering through the crawl space above Miss Branson's apartment. She slipped, plunging her leg through the ceiling, much to the surprise of the headmistress and her dog. As the Depression began to wane, the girls were allowed more freedom to travel to the city for theater and symphony visits, and in 1937, the Vagabonds took a walk across the newly opened Golden Gate Bridge. This journal entry describes how they encountered a turnstile that wouldn't accept their toll, and they were helped out into traffic by a friendly policeman. The entire school went on to walk the Golden Gate Bridge in October of 1940, and by the late 40s, the school's annual Bay excursions included a cruise and a walk across the bridge. In 1936, the board was confident enough to increase tuition as well as faculty salaries. Banks were also feeling that the worst of the Depression was behind them, and they were willing to lend money to the school in 1937 to purchase the former home of Inez Faskin, which the girls dubbed Crossways because it stood directly across from the original residence. Finally, I want to share this great photo of the pomp and ceremony accompanying the installation of our current flagpole on Abraham Lincoln's birthday in 1933. The bombing of Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941 had, as it did for millions of Americans, a profound effect on the girls at 39 Fern Hill. One alum recounted that she and a group of girls were walking that morning from St. John's down Shady Lane when they began to encounter neighbors spilling out into the street in confusion and shock of the news. Up until that moment, the school was aware of the fighting in Europe and of the scarcity of food and supplies for its citizens. Here you can see the Christmas production of The Story of World War in 1939, and earlier a new course in The Problems of Democracy had been added to the curriculum. In March of 1942, the editor of the Blueprint wrote passionately about the impact of the war and the serious need to practice economy and conservation of resources. The school immediately shortened the hours of the day to save energy, air raid practices became regular events, and students increased their Red Cross and community service activities with their Ross neighbors as the war continued, including giving blood, making bandages, mending hospital linen, and sewing hospital gowns. Some even assisted at Hamilton Field in Nevada, which then served as a hospital for wounded GIs. Resident students from Hawaii were forbidden to return home for the duration of the war. Girls were compelled to take on extra domestic chores when much of the grounds and housing staff of the school were again laid off. For most of them, this was a new experience of democracy. The 1944 school catalog quoted one student, "Chores have taught me how the other half have lived, how spoiled we have been, and how unduly fortunate. Chores to me mean that all here at KBS, like the rest of the world, are working towards one goal, to free the earth from tyranny now and forever." Students at the Katharine Branson School took an active interest in the progress of the war, and their current event assemblies were often their favorite part of the day. They also corresponded with students at L'École de Cléderie, inspired by their French teacher. Through these letters, the KBS girls learned about the lives of French citizens in the heart of the conflict and of the hardships of German occupation. Branson students sent hundreds of dollars and supplies to the 65 pupils and their families in the war-torn French village, including packages of clothing, yards of material, shoes, candy, and toys to the children of the village, both during and after the war. All during the war, however, school life went on and the girls continued with their education and activities. On-campus athletics, such as this 1942 volleyball game and a vagabond hike to a dilapidated vehicle in that same year, were useful outlets. Even play week continued on every spring as another distraction from the realities of war. The post-war years brought a revitalized program of study that soon included a course in current events and history elective courses to follow the 10th grade U.S. history curriculum, which is still the model in our history department. Courses in chemistry and Spanish were also added to further prepare the students for the rigors of college. The great number of challenges that the school faced in the 1930s and 1940s, however, could not fully prepare the community for the one major challenge that proved unavoidable, Miss Branson's retirement. On October 23, 1950, school founder George Hind died suddenly, and within 1 week, Catherine announced her retirement after 30 years as headmistress. Mr. Hind had been a staunch supporter of Miss Branson in the school, and she had grown to depend upon his counsel and friendship. Although the board postponed her departure and the search for her replacement, Miss Branson took the matter into her own hands and invited George Terrell from the Foxcroft School in Virginia to visit the school. Upon meeting Mr. Terrell, the board offered him the position of headmaster, and the Catherine Branson era soon came to an end. Catherine Branson announced her decision to retire and that her choice of replacement was George Terrell publicly on April 20th, 1951. At Prize Day in June of that year, the board conferred upon her the honor of Headmistress Emeritus, proclaiming, "This school is the history of her useful life. It will always bear her imprint. It will never forget her." She had shaped the school, guided its development, created and supervised its curricula, hired its faculty and staff, chosen its students, and built its philosophies and traditions. Miss Branson relocated to her home in Carmel by the Sea and kept in close contact with many of her girls, corresponding regularly with them through their marriages and the births of their children, compiling a touching scrapbook of all of her correspondence with alumni over the years. This portrait of Miss Branson and her beloved dog, painted by Jose Moya del Pino, now hangs in her library in Residence Hall. George Terrell began his tenure at KBS with plans to revitalize the residence halls and classrooms, to strengthen the quality of the curriculum, and add to an aging teaching staff. Known for his force of personality, his occasional bombast, and for a certain fondness for shouting out "once more" into the breach at the end of assemblies, the newly appointed headmaster set about his task with a strong vision for the school. When Terrell arrived in 1951, the school had only 83 total students, and by the next fall, the number had shrunk to 74, continuing a trend that had been established early in the post-war years. The population of Marin was booming, however, and other schools around the county and throughout the state were meeting the demand for state-of-the-art science laboratories, libraries, theaters, and music rooms. The lack of adequate resident space at KBS forced the school to even turn away applicants, further deepening the financial hole. Under his leadership, the trustees purchased Newhouse, the Carruthers' elegant home with its beautiful English garden that stood right on campus at the top of the hill between Crossways and Residence. Although the school still struggled with the financial deficits left over from decades of low enrollment and economic difficulties, his push for improvements compelled the board to completely renovate the residence halls at Crossways and Newhouse and construct a new academic building, although not until after Terrell's departure in 1954. Plans were also developed to construct a new science building and a modern cafeteria, both of which would happen within the next decade. He also joined with the faculty in welcoming suggestions from a group of parents interested in helping the school by recommending to the board the establishment of the first Parents Association. As the 1950s progressed, the newer teachers brought excitement to the classroom, and many of the very strict rules began to relax. The girls still found serenity in the beautiful campus and the fun of parties, vagabond trips into the hills, team athletic competitions, and the lifelong friendships all added to the changing atmosphere at the school. In the end, George Terrell's gruff and combative personality proved too much for the board to overlook. In the middle of the 1954-1955 school year, he was asked to resign. Although the faculty rallied in his defense, Terrell had not formed strong ties in the community, and he and his wife returned to England. His successor, named interim head that winter, was none other than his assistant, history teacher, Virginia Jennings. The Branson board selected Jennings as headmistress because it had found in her warmth, sympathy, and a concern for the girls, along with excellent organizational skills, a buoyant nature, a strong sense of responsibility, and an unassuming manner, the very qualities they sought in a head. She was open and compassionate, and she immediately set out to create a more inviting atmosphere on campus, one that the girls certainly responded to. She stressed a love for learning and a commitment to a broad liberal arts education. She made herself a friend of the students and alumni alike and sought to improve the cultural appreciation of the students by reinvigorating music and language instruction and reestablishing regular attendance at the symphony, museum, concerts, and plays in San Francisco. Jennings recruited younger women to the faculty, and she made the appointment of the first full-time male teacher in the school's history in 1955. She inaugurated the new tradition of Prize Day being held down the hill, and the 1956 class was the last to graduate under the majestic blue spruce. She also hired the school's first librarian in 1955. She encouraged the young women to establish and work on the new school newspaper, The Blazer, to engage in athletic competitions, to perform in the spring play, serve on student council, or attend concerts and recitals, all to find a sense of balance. Seen by everyone as fair and moderate, she won students' confidence by ensuring that she knew each student's name and that she greeted each girl every day. Girls of the era remember her tenure as one that provided a nurturing environment where one learned to play, be creative, and be an individual. During Jennings' tenure, the board fulfilled Terrell's goals by renovating both Crossways and the newly acquired New House, which it began filling with resident students, as well as constructing the new study hall, adding desperately needed classrooms and meeting space. Enrollment rebounded so much that before long the school was enrolling 130 or more students each year, a significant increase compared to recent years, with almost equal number of day and resident girls. In a few short years, the applications of day students would soar by more than 75%, and by the spring of 1962, as the school was preparing to graduate its largest class in history, Branson received applications for every resident vacancy. Although many traditions continued, some fell away. Play Week was discontinued in the 1950s, and the Blueprint, which had functioned as a literary magazine and school yearbook since 1920, gave way in 1961 to a more modern style yearbook. When Marin Country Day School added eighth grade to its program of studies in 1958, the trustees agreed to discontinue eighth grade at the Katherine Branson School in 1959. Jennings' tenure also witnessed the beginning of construction of the new cafeteria on the upper campus near the residences in 1961, which functioned as our dining hall well into 2009. In 1961, however, in spite of strong enrollment numbers and positive changes to the school, Jennings was abruptly dismissed during the summer break. She had become increasingly distant from the students and faculty following a divorce, and several parents had brought concerns to the board and requested her resignation. Shortly after her departure, the board appointed an interim headmistress. However, after only 2 months, she left for health reasons, and the board once again turned to Katherine Branson, at that time already more than 10 years into her retirement. Katherine accepted and reassumed the role of headmistress for the remainder of the school year. Although most in the community were relieved to have her back, she soon tried to bring a tone of discipline and expectation reminiscent of the early days at campus, against which students sometimes struggled. At the end of her interim year, the board was successful in bringing David Jackson as the new head of school, bringing with him his youth and enthusiasm, as he was only 33, the same age as Miss Branson when she came to the school. He had a love of the arts and an active outdoor life. Almost immediately, Jackson made changes to the academic schedule and the curriculum, adding what he called minor courses or seminars in studio art, earth science, drama, comparative religions, journalism, space science, medical biology, and music appreciation. By 1964, the school was once again offering classes in civics and art history, a course covering the Bible, others in the history of music, and additional advanced placement courses in history and English. All of these changes were made in light of his concern that the curriculum needed to be refreshed and modernized, and that the relationships between teachers and students needed to be more open and harmonious. Jackson was committed to modernizing the school and to easing the rules and regulations that the resident girls had to observe, especially after the short return of Miss Branson, to develop a more open, a more considerate, and a more caring environment for the girls. He dropped the requirement that students from San Francisco had to reside on campus, and the number of applicants rose. Jackson also urged the board to look at future planning and to launch the first fundraising drive. Soon, the board commissioned a consulting firm to develop a master plan in the fall of 1963, the first formal plan in the school's history. It called for the construction of an auditorium for multi-purpose use and a new science building, as well as relocation of the creek that ran through campus to make room for more and larger athletic fields. All of these plans would be completed by the early 1970s. In 1965, Jackson was faced with a difficult decision about a student disciplinary action just days before graduation. He allowed the student to graduate, and although the group of trustees with whom Jackson consulted supported the decision, it soon came under fire from some parents and other board members. After considerable reflection during a difficult and turbulent summer, when school resumed that fall, Jackson submitted his resignation effective at the end of June 1966. In Jackson's final year at KBS, the school experienced its first independent external study of its programs conducted by the Western Association of Secondary Schools. The WASC appraisal highlighted the school's promise and its problems, and perhaps served as vindication of those who had been seeking greater reform and change. In this first extensive comprehensive evaluation of the school, the following strengths were noted. 1, the variety and vitality of its curricular offerings. 2, the individual attention given to learners. 3, the informal counseling provided by its faculty. And 4, the quality of the teaching faculty. As recommendations, the WASC committee called for the school to involve the students in more community projects to increase social awareness and positive social guidance for the girls, and to put together a more cohesive planned curriculum for every grade. More urgent, they said, was to introduce a coordinated program in the sciences. And with only one laboratory for biology, chemistry, and physics, the school must remedy that fault with new construction. Since that initial evaluation, the school has had WASC visits every 6 years, giving us insight into the strengths of our program and recommendations for improvements and growth. By the mid-1960s, the world outside the gates of KBS were changing in fundamental ways. The Vietnam War, the civil rights and free speech movements, and the electric shifts in music and lifestyles exploding just across the bridge became impossible to ignore within the sheltered life of the school. In early 1966, the Blazer was full of articles about dances, recitals, and a hiking trip to Bolinas. By the end of that year and into 1969, the girls began to write about drugs, the ongoing war, and figures in the news such as Eldridge Cleaver. Into this turbulent time, the school invited H. Len Richardson to take the helm as headmaster. Richardson, as one board member later recalled, bowled over the committee seeking a successor to David Jackson. The school had never attracted such an able or experienced headmaster. Richardson has spent his entire schooling and career in independent schools before coming to Branson in 1966. Richard's initial meeting with trustees in the beginning of 1966 would establish the agenda for the next 16 years at KBS. Presiding over an era of the most rapid change in the school's history, Richardson led its transformation to a coeducational school, expanded its admission of minorities, added major renovations to the school's academic buildings and sports facilities, increased academic offerings, developed extramural sports, raised academic standards, and nearly replaced the entire faculty. Beyond all that, he stressed that the schools must maintain a core of moral and ethical standards. Over 50 years later, our school, our core mission, and our values still echo these transformative goals that Richardson met. For all the changes that Lynn Richardson brought to the school, none was important as his mandate that the school had to expand its student body. He knew that girls' boarding schools nationwide were in decline and that an all-female boarding school might not survive in a modern age. He also saw that the diversity of the Bay Area was not reflected in the students of the school in 1966, and he wanted to increase minority enrollment. Richardson's view was that co-education was the way the school could enlarge its student body and its financial base without necessarily sacrificing standards, since theoretically it would be doubling its applicant pool. To preserve the charm and traditions of the Katherine Branson School, Richardson favored a coordinate school model, whereby a boys' school would be located apart from the main Ross campus, but share faculty and resources and retain the goals and mission of the established school. Although the board was initially reluctant to make such a momentous change to the traditions of KBS, enthusiasm for the idea began to grow, and they began the search for a site for a boys' school. Their search led them first to a very promising site on Laurel Avenue in Ross, the Dominican Novitiate. Having recently been listed for sale, the Novitiate grounds of more than 10 acres had tennis courts, a large playing field, several classroom buildings, sufficient parking, and ample space for a gymnasium and other necessary buildings. And the location was less than 2 miles from the Katherine Branson School. In June of 1970, however, plans to take over the site were dropped. Earlier in 1968, as a prelude to opening a boys' school, KBS planned a student exchange with the Thatcher School in Ojai, at that time an all-boys boarding school. The initial Thatcher exchange of 40 for 40 took place in March of 1969 and then again in February 1970. Special seminars were created for the exchange, including ones investigating problems facing American youth in the modern world and the history and experiences of African Americans. Although many board members had been dismayed at the failure to secure the Laurel Grove property in Ross, Richardson was undeterred. At the time, the only non-sectarian school for boys in the area was Lick Wilmerding in San Francisco. The school even considered merging with the San Rafael Military Academy, now Marin Academy, but the proposal was abandoned when each school resisted relinquishing its own distinctive character and founding ideals. After eliminating several potential sites in Marin, the steering committee recommended establishing the Mount Tamalpais School for Boys on the Ross campus. With trustee and Ross Town Council member John Chase chosen to spearhead a public relations effort, the school's board announced on September 21, 1971, its intention to obtain permission and start a boys' coordinate school on the Katherine Branson School campus in the fall of 1972. While the arrival of boys would signal a monumental change in school culture, most of the girls were excited by the freedom and spirit that the boys brought to the school. And the greater community's interest in coeducation was plain to see. By January 1972, the school had received more than 150 applications from boys for admission to the Mount Tamalpais School, and the number of applicants to the Katherine Branson School increased significantly that winter as well. In 1971, the school enrolled only 132 girls. In the fall of 1972, the combined enrollment of the two schools on campus was 196, of which 53 were boys. You can see a few of those first boys here on the steps of Residence Hall in 1972. For the first couple of years, there really were two schools on the same campus, different classes, two graduations, two yearbooks, and two headmasters. By year four, however, the classrooms had boys with girls, and there was one graduation ceremony, one yearbook, and for all intents and purposes, the school was coeducational. But by the time the Mount Tamalpais School opened, it had become clear that supporting a boarding and a day school simply cost too much to continue. In 1978, the Board of Trustees officially ended the boarding program, and by 1982, the last boarders had graduated. The last two girls actually lived with Mr. Richardson and his family at One Circle Drive. On March 18, 1985, Miss Katherine Branson passed away at the age of 98. At her service, Mr. Richardson spoke of her unswerving devotion to excellence, saying that she had a conviction that if a thing were worth doing, it was worth doing well, a faith in the young, a belief that excellence was important, that rigor was essential in building character. Even before Miss Branson's death, the school was changing in fundamental ways. Long-standing clubs, such as the hiking club, the Vagabonds, and the acting club, the Fantastics, had fallen apart. Some girls began to resent wearing the traditional uniforms besides the informal uniform of jeans and t-shirts for Mount Tam boys. The two separate schools were merging in almost all aspects. In the fall of 1985, the changes were official. School uniforms were no longer required, and the schools were merged and renamed the Branson School. By the 1990s, the school acknowledged that it was sending students into a world much more diverse than the predominantly white Branson. In 1989, two members of the Board of Trustees had started Making Waves in Richmond as an after-school program giving children a chance to control their own destiny by encouraging them to stay in school. During the summer of 1990, almost 50 wave makers joined Branson Tutors, first in Richmond, and later during the summers on our campus. Today, that energy lives on in our connections with A Better Chance and Next Generation Scholars, two organizations committed to helping high school students reach their goals of attending college. In 1992, junior Andretta Lyle created Gospel Night to, in her words, facilitate her own inclusion as an African descendant student. Since then, Gospel Night has packed our theater every year, when the music on stage and the energy from the audience create an experience both exhilarating and uplifting. You can't see me, but I'm in this photo from Gospel Night in February of this year. In 1993, the Bess K. Gillard Teaching Fellowship was established in honor of the grandmother of a Branson student, a teacher dedicated to the education of all children. The Gillard Fellowship has allowed Branson to hire graduates of Morehouse and Spelman Colleges as faculty members to encourage them to pursue a career in education. Here you see three current Branson faculty members, all former Gillard Fellows, and the years of their fellowships. Athletics has been a part of Branson from the very beginning, when Miss Branson created the Blue Bonnets and the Tam O'Shanters for competition within the school. In 2000, Branson left the Bay Counties League, comprised of independent schools around the Bay Area, and joined the Marin County Athletic League, a gutsy move for such a small school. We entered into an agreement with the College of Marin in December of that year that allowed our teams to use that campus's facilities to support our move to MCAL. Branson was ready. Since 2000, the school has won 167 league championships, 79 North Coast Section Championships, 73 NorCal Regional Championships, and 12 state championships. Branson's boys and girls basketball teams had success over the years, but never got past the Northern California Finals. Then in 2006, after losing the previous year at Arco Arena, the boys basketball team, led by Jonas Honick, won the California State Championship. 90% of our students and faculty bussed up to Sacramento to witness their historic win. The following year, the girls' team joined them in victory, and our small but mighty basketball teams went on to win both state championships the following year. Our beautiful campus has been a constant through 100 years, and original buildings like residence and Richardson Halls add to our sense of tradition and time. However, by the mid-2000s, most of the buildings on campus lacked functionality. We literally had computer wires looped through basement windows. As the business manager at the time remarked, it was time to do the upgrade that the school needed and students deserved. A team of architects led by Mary Griffin, a parent of two Branson alums, designed our beautiful commons, Maxwell Music Hall, and our sculpture in digital media labs to not only be very comfortable and aesthetically pleasing, and by the way, Sierra Magazine called our commons the world's coolest student center in 2012. But they built them to be LEED certified, a symbol of sustainable, efficient, and healthy buildings. In 2018, two dozen current and former faculty, alumni, parents, and board members came together over the course of a year to write a strategic plan for the school, the first in a decade. titled A Look Ahead, A Purpose Beyond, it challenged the school to revisit and innovate its already strong curriculum and to recommit itself to its core values, its commitment to a diverse community, and its commitment to supporting its faculty to live in the Bay Area. It introduced the school's now succinct but powerful mission statement. Branson develops students who make a positive impact in the world by leading lives of integrity, purpose, learning, and joy. It also established the community's four core values that have become the guides for navigating our second century: courage, kindness, honor, and purpose. Within a week of countywide school closures in March of 2020, in response to the COVID-19 pandemic, a team of Branson teachers and administrators developed a distance learning plan, and teachers and students both rose to the challenge of creating an engaging learning environment online. Over the course of several weeks, the school refined the schedule, established an equitable grading system, and modified course content to be responsive to the needs of students during a difficult time. It has been a shining example of the Branson community's willingness to grow and respond to the present moment. Here you can see members of Danny Lee's poetry class creating a timely poem on Zoom. The 2020-21 school year has recently started, with teachers and students once again connecting entirely online. As a gift to the school, several students spent the spring and summer recreating our Ross campus in the online world of Minecraft, complete with playing fields, music rooms, and even the library to give everyone the sense of place that is so important to our students. They love and miss our school. They miss being in the classroom with their teachers and friends and just taking part in everything that makes up our small community. We miss them too. In 1920, the catalog for the newly renamed Katherine Branson School stated its purpose as giving girls a thorough academic foundation to prepare them to take an active and intelligent part in the activities of any community in which they may live. 100 years later, our mission statement echoes that purpose. And as we continue to prepare students for a future that we can't foresee, for career paths that have not yet been invented, and to live in an ever-changing world, our mission will stand strong, and so will Branson. Thank you.
Thank you, Laurie.
Okay, Joe, you are now the host.
Okay. Thank you, Laurie. Thank you for that wonderful presentation.
You're welcome. I love talking about the school.
I can't think of a more perfect presentation to launch our very first Zoom first Friday forenoon.
Right. So
made a little history today by being the first for that.
Yes, you're getting a taste of what our teachers and students are going through right now.
I know it's really something else. my 12-year-old is going through that right now. Now we have a few questions. Can you see those?
I am looking at them. Okay. So Katherine Branson's sister. So the question was, what happened to Katherine Branson's sister and what was her first name? She had actually several sisters. There were five altogether. One of them, I can't remember her first name, was a well-known painter. And in fact, she painted a portrait of Miss Branson that is hanging in Richardson Hall. But the sister that came west with her was Laura Branson. She was a mathematics teacher, and she and Katherine could not have been more different. So Laura was very political minded and supported Eugene Debs, and I think that she found that that leading the school at Branson was I guess. The strictures that her sister had put in were not her style. So she actually left and went back east. And unfortunately, she passed away in the mid-40s. I think there was a car accident that she was killed. Let's see. And then the next question. Oh, so another question about Miss Branson's sister, Laura. We have a member of the last all-girl class at KBS. She says, the first year of co-education was rocky, and it was all because of the challenges of keeping up with longtime traditions while building new ones. Yes, that tension I've read about several times when looking at that period of time. And I hope that I was able to convey that a little bit. And I don't see any other questions. Somebody says that Mr. Richardson sang evening prayer from Fiddler on the Roof. I actually met Lynn Richardson before he passed away, and he was one of the most impressive gentlemen I've ever met in education. And he had this sonorous voice, and he was very sweet and very thoughtful, and was an amazing listener. He listened to you when you talked. So I imagine that when he was head of school, that he really had a huge impact on everyone. Oh, and FYI, the class of 75 had senior vespers at St. John's. Thank you. Is there anything in the chat room that we missed?
Maybe we'll see. We'll give people another minute to post a question if they have any.
Okay, I actually am seeing something in the chat room, not the Q&A. Somebody asks about the online database. It's open to the public. You actually can find it by going to the Branson website at www.branson.org. And if you hover over About Us, the very first link to click is History. And there you'll find a link to the archives, the searchable archives. And yes, you can browse or search by a student or a teacher's name. And I have cataloged it all. So you can find every mention of you, every photograph that we have of you so far, every article you wrote for the Blazer, and so forth. Let's see. So there is a question about participation in events with boys from other schools, and definitely yes. I didn't include them, but I have many, many photographs of dances where they had invited boys from another school back into the 50s. So they definitely allowed boys on campus. So I think that's it. Any other questions? And then somebody asks if the video will be available to the public. So I'll leave that to you, Joe.
Yes, to answer that question, your presentation, Laurie, has been recorded, and as soon as Zoom has processed it, they'll provide a link, and we will be happy to share that with everyone who attended today. And I think we might have one more comment here in the chat room. From Betsy.
Yes, I actually had the insert from the Blazer newspaper for that exchange in the 70s. We did it in 1969 and then again in 1970. So we did two exchanges. Yes.
Fantastic.
Well, Laurie, thank you. That was a wonderful program.
You're welcome.
Learned a lot, saw a lot of photographs that brought back a lot of memories. And we really appreciate you making the effort to share all of your research with the Ross Historical Society, Moya Library.
Of course.
And to all the listeners out there, I hope you will be interested in signing up for our next two meetings in October and November. And thank you for your support and interest.
And thank you, everybody. This will conclude our first Friday forenoon presentation today. Everybody have a wonderful day.
Thank you.